So I used to spend hours editing photos and still somehow end up with results that looked boring, muddy, and just simply wrong. But now, after 10 years of editing photos, both for myself and professionally, I've finally figured out what I was doing wrong, and once I did, editing went from frustrating guesswork to results that I'm actually proud of. And in this video, my friend, I'll break down 5 things I personally wish I'd learned earlier, because this will instantly change the way that you edit your photos. All right, tip number 1. When I first started editing, I thought that presets were some sort of magic solution, or the magic solution, I should say. So naturally, I downloaded every free preset pack that I could find, I slapped them on my photos, and told myself, yep, that is editing, baby. But here's the problem. I didn't actually know what was happening. I did not understand what the preset was changing or why the photo looked the way it did after I've applied it. And that is a major trap in my opinion. Look, presets are absolutely amazing. I use them almost every day and I sell my own. But when you're just starting out, I worry that they become some sort of a crutch. You understand? Because you're skipping the part where you actually learn what these sliders do. I had this conversation not so long ago on a one-on-one call with a student, and she was really overwhelmed by tone curves. And she was relying on presets all the time. And I asked her, why are you using that preset? She constantly said to me, I don't know, I just think it looks good. And I was like, what is it about it that looks good? And she didn't really understand or know why, just in certain situations, that preset worked and that preset didn't work. But the problem I saw is that she didn't understand what the preset were actually doing under the hood. And that is a massive problem. Look, I've been there myself. I relied on preset for years and it honestly just slowed me down because I wasn't building the instinct that I needed to edit with confidence. That's some Viking coming at you there. So my friend, if you're feeling stuck, here is my honest advice. Don't rely on presets to begin with. Learn the tools first, understand how exposure, contrast, color work together, and then you can bring preset back into your mix or your workflow and they stop being a crutch and start becoming your supercharger. I'm not sure why I'm doing this right here. I'm just feeling a little bit pumped talking to you. Anyway, once you step away from the presets and start editing on your own, there is another trap that I see almost everybody fall into, me included, and it can completely ruin your photos if you're not careful. By the way, I made a free 33-day email series with 1 short tip a day to help you level up your editing game. It's totally free and you can find it in the description down below. Tip number 2. All right, so once I stopped relying on preset myself, I honestly thought that I had it all figured out. Big boy shit, you know? But then I kind of went just straight into another big mistake. I pushed everything way too far. My skies were just nuclear blue. My shadows totally pitch black. And every photo looked like it had been dipped into one of those, you know, Instagram filters from 2012. Or you can say 2012. Which do you say? I have no idea which I should say. 2012. We say that. Where am I going with this? Anyway, here's the thing. Doing this felt good in the moment because when you're dragging sliders all the way, you see a big change. And it feels like progress. I bet many of you have taken that clarity slider when you saw it for the first time and just dragged it all the way to the right and be like, oh, that looks sick. Been there, done that multiple times. But here's the thing, more often than not, it just makes our photos look fake and heavy-handed. It's just too much, you know? Full disclaimer though, I absolutely love editing my photos like a ton. I think it's really fun and I think it's creative. I can get absolutely lost in the creative process. But here's the truth. Subtlety. Is that the English word? Subtly. Being subtle, you understand what I'm trying to say. Subtle changes is often what makes an edit feel professional. Small, controlled changes add up to one big difference. And usually less is more. It's like with everything in life, my friend. Unless, of course, you're going for a super stylized look. Then, of course, just go mayhem on it, my friend. At the end of the day, photography, it's art. And art, it is subjective. If it feels good to you, then who the hell am I to tell you that it sucks? That being said though, over-editing, it's definitely a thing and not just a myth. And because I've done it so much myself, I've developed a little rule or a little trick. I don't know what you want to call it. Basically, it helps me tremendously with not taking my edits too far. And here's how it works. You see, once you've finished editing your photo, then I recommend stepping away from the screen. It could be for just a few minutes or an entire day, and it's up to you and your busy schedule. I do this because it's so easy to get blinded by your edits and lose perspective. But when you come back with a fresh pair of eyes, it's immediately clear if you've gone too far or if your photo actually needs some more tweaks. So yeah, if you look at your photo and you think to yourself, why doesn't this feel right? Chances are that you might been, you know, over-edited. However, and I don't want to be the bearer of bad news, but none of this really clicks until you understand one key thing. And that is something that, in my opinion, or what I've noticed, most editing tutorials completely skip. They don't talk about this. Which brings us to tip number three. So for the longest time, I would just open up Lightroom, start moving some sliders around, and hope that something cool would just happen. Truth is that sometimes it works. Sometimes I got some sick edits. But most of the time, my edits just felt random. Can you relate to this? Basically, one photo would end up warm and soft, the next may be cold and dramatic, and nothing really matched. But here's the thing that I eventually realized. I wasn't asking myself the most important question. What do I actually want this photo to feel like? That is the key, my friend. Before you touch a photo or before you touch a single slider, pause and just think, what is the subject here? What do I want people to notice first? And what is the mood that I'm going for? You understand? Do I want this photo to feel warm and nostalgic, cold and moody? Maybe I want it to be clean and modern. And once you have that, how can I say it in good English, emotional anchor, every decision in your editing becomes so much easier because you're not guessing anymore. You're shaping the photo to match your vision. Oof, that Icelandic guy on fire. Now, by the way, don't get me wrong here. This doesn't mean that you can't experiment. Of course you can. But even with exploration, you should have some sort of direction. Otherwise, in my opinion, you'll just end up like Christopher Columbus. You're setting out for India and accidentally you discover America. Sure, that like worked out for bro, but maybe it wasn't the most efficient way to get to where you wanted to go. You know, I say a lot of you know, don't I? Basically, the point that I'm trying to drive home here is that editing can feel the same. You can wander around and sometimes you land on something cool. But when you start with intent, you actually know where you are headed. Whether you understand it or not, let me then show you what I'm talking about. We jump into Lightroom now, okay? All right, my friends, so welcome to inside of the program itself. And let me show you what I mean when I'm talking about editing with intent. So this is a pretty decent example of this, what I'm talking about. And this here is how it looked like unedited. So when I look at this photo, or any photo really, the first thing that I try to think about is, of course, establishing subject and all that. We're going to dive in a second. But one major thing that I'm trying to figure out is, what do I want this photo to feel like? Because it gives me an anchor on what direction I'm gonna move with it. Of course I can change it later on. I mean, nothing that we do here is set in stone. So if we were to do it here, I'm saying, okay, I want this photo to feel really, really cold. First I start by cropping the photo just a little bit, all right? And then I like would start to edit it. And okay, this is looking pretty decent. We add some contrast to it, all right? And now I know that I want this photo to be really, really, really cool. So it starts with, of course, HSL sliders. I would like to remove a lot of greens and yellows to get more moody tone. But because I want that moody, 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 cold tone, then I would go to the color grading tab and start to push in a ton of blue colors in the shadows, highlights, and maybe even midtones, depending on the photo itself. But this gives me a clear direction, and not only with the color scheme, but also with the masking. I want it to be dramatic. So I did a ton of masks here to darken this corner here, and then I have mask up here on the haze to help emphasize on the haze. If I were, instead of wanting this photo to be warm and nostalgic, I would have gone differently. Then the edit would look like this. Now here I went with a little mix, a little bit of like moody too. So it's a moody, warm, cozy photo, if that makes sense. But you think you understand what I'm trying to do. And whatever photo that I'm looking at, whether it's this photo right here, or it's this photo right here, then the first thing that I think about is always, how do I want this photo to feel? And then I have a general direction. By the way, if this kind of thinking about editing makes sense to you, you'd love my Lightroom Masterclass. It's basically everything that I learned over the past 10 years of editing photos packed into one simple, step-by-step, easy to follow along course that actually shows you not just what to do inside of Lightroom, but also how to think about photo editing. And of course, I will walk you through real edit, show you my exact step-by-step process, and help you build your own style and edit with confidence. And finally, also understand how to use and edit photos in Lightroom on a much deeper level. I mean, I got this photo sent a few days ago by Andrew, who completed the course not so long ago. He's pretty new to Lightroom, and just notice how he cleaned up the water, played with the light, and managed to create a really dreamy vibe. Great job. There's a massive difference between the raw photo and the edited one. So my friend, if you've ever felt like editing is overwhelming, or like your photos never quite match the vision that you have in your head, or if you even already have a solid foundation but you want to level up, this course is made for you. At the time of the recording, almost 300 photographers have taken it, which is absolutely just wild to me. And I can confidently say that your editing skills will dramatically improve in just 30 days. And if not, I'll give you your money back. In the description, there's a link and you can check it out if this interests you. All right, so let's then get into the next step. Tip number four. So once you know the intent of your photo, the next step is to make sure that your subject is actually clear. And this is where I see a lot of edits fall apart, at least in my humble Icelandic opinion. You see, you might have a great shot, but if the viewer doesn't instantly know where they're supposed to look at, the photo runs a chance of just feeling confusing. You understand? Do you really understand? Why am I saying this all the time? Basically, this is where editing becomes less about fixing mistakes and more about guiding the viewer's eye. There are multiple things that I do to help me with this. Cropping is one of the simplest tools. You can cut out the distractions, tighten the frame, and suddenly the photo just feels much more intentional. It's basically one of the first things that I do actually, and it helps me get the composition just right and also helps removing distractions if needed. Cropping is goated, you know. Masks are another magical game changer. You can darken the background or foreground, lift the exposure on your subject, or add subtle contrast in just the right places. These little tweaks are what gives your photo focus and it makes it feel much more polished. Polished. Basically, masks are an amazing tool to help you isolate the subject because you have so much control and can do local adjustments. That's what I'm trying to say. You see, the goal is quite simple. The subject should be obvious. Even if someone only glances at your photo for just a second, their eye should exactly know where you wanted to go. Make sense? Or at least this is at least how I think about photography. And again, let's jump into Lightroom and let me show you what the hell I'm talking about. All right, so we are back in Lightroom, and what I want to show you right now is how I try to isolate the subject. On this photo right here, I'm basically creating a few masks to help close in on the subject. And the first thing that I do, or I said that to the intent, so it's probably the second thing that I do, or somewhere in the beginning of the editing process, is establishing a subject. On some photos, it's really obvious. In this photo, I mean, it's obviously this little sky train or whatever you want to call it here, the ski lift. It's actually a ski lift. On other photos, it's less obvious. On this bird photo, really, really, really obvious. And what I do then, I'm creating a bunch of masks, I'll show you here, to help isolated. It happens, of course, both with the crop. That is usually the first thing that I do. I crop the photo in a way that helps clear the subject, makes it, whether it is align it. Here I'm making sure that this is in the middle. I thought this here feels a little bit off. You see there's a slight difference, but it's a big difference actually. It's just nicer when it is, it's total in the center. I personally want to have it on like the third of the frame, so we're going for a little rule of third composition. And in other scenarios, maybe there might be tree branches. For instance, on the photo that I showed you here, there are some ugly tree branches down here that I don't think are nice. And then I can use the crop to remove distractions and just crop them away. This is a little bit too much, but you get what I'm trying to like say here. But I'm also using a ton of masks to help further isolate the subject. Whether it is a mask down here to darken the foreground, or a mask up here to brighten up the foreground or darken it, depending on the photo. Now the light source is coming in this direction, so use mask here to help just create a little bit of haze up there. And it makes the foreground a little bit less noticeable, but it also pushes light towards our subject. And then I have a mask in the middle too, to help bring more light to it. I could add more mask, maybe a subject mask if I wanted to, and drag up the exposure here if that is what I want. The choice are endless and it's up to you to decide. But once you've got a clear subject, there's still one more piece of the puzzle. And this should not be ignored, because if you do, then no amount of editing tricks or techniques will save the photo. Which brings us to, ladies and gentlemen, tip number 5. So the last big mistake I made for years was ignoring the light. Basically, I try my best to brute force a photo into something it wasn't, you know? I'm talking things like cranking up the contrast and warmth to make overcast day look like golden hour, or try at least. Spoiler alert, it never works, and your photo always ends up feeling, you know, off. Here's the thing, you can't fake the light, but you can shape it. I should maybe not say fake. Some of you Photoshop wizard be like, challenge accepted. But you know what I'm trying to say. Here's how I try to think about it nowadays. Instead of fighting the light, work with it. And ask yourself, what kind of light is there actually in this image? Is it soft? Is it harsh? Is it directional? And then you use your edit to enhance it, not to pretend like it is something else. This is again where masks are insanely powerful. You can brighten certain areas where the light would naturally fall on, deepen the shadows if you want to, or add subtle gradients to give your photo much more depth. With other words, it's not about inventing new light out of nowhere, it's about supporting the light that is already there. And you see, one of my favorite things to do when I'm editing my photos is to take absolute full control of the light and shape it directly with masks. This is something that I talk about a ton. Let me show you how. We jump into Lightroom, me and you. Have a good time, you know. Not that type of good time. This is much better, I promise, okay? All right, so in Lightroom here, let me show you my what's probably one of my favorite techniques. So on this photo right here, you can clearly see it, that I like to take control of the light and shape it. So with a bunch of masks, I am, just to show you, this is with the masks on and here with the masks off. You see the difference? I am controlling the light and shaping it. I do this by using masks. Most often, our most simplest version is basically to place a mask in the corner of where the sun is actually coming from. You cannot go and put it here because you can see the shadows. The sun is actually in this direction, so it just start weird. But I add a light source, and this is a radial filter. So up here, click and add a radial filter. And I'm just assuming that you know this. So if you know, need a more basic tutorial, I have more beginner-friendly tutorials too. But this is a radial filter, and then I drag down the dehaze and clarity. This makes a really nice bloomy effect. If you wanted to, you can take up the exposure. And if you want to make it warm, maybe it's sunlight, warm sunlight coming in there, you can drag up the temperature as well. That is something that you can play with. But I'd like to place it here somewhere and help shape the light. And this creates a nice light source. Now, there are more like examples I can give you here, because this is a killer little technique that I use all the time. For instance, you can see it on this photo right here. Here are a bunch of masks that I created. This is without, and this is with. This is more subtle than the other one. The other one was quite extreme. You can see the change is very, very big. But here, still, look how flat this photo is, and look how more three-dimensional this is. Basically, I have masks here that I'm darkening the foreground. I did not move them up here because the sun is coming from this direction, and I didn't want to darken things here because it would look weird. And then I have this big mask that I showed you before, I added it here, and now I decided to add one more mask that is in different shape, more shaped as a cone, kind of, and I'm thinking about this as a beam. So this is similar effect, but I'm just moving it more towards the down here in the fjord. That's where I wanted the main focus of this photo to be like. Then, of course, I have mask in the middle to brighten it up and help any things. So these are a bunch of different masks, and I sometimes get the question, why all these masks? Because in my opinion, I rather have many different types of masks that have small changes, so I have greater control. All right, this is a way for me to shape the photo in much more detail and had just established so much more control. So yeah, once you stop relying on preset, avoid over-editing, editing with intent, isolate your subject and my friend shaping the light, that's when editing, in my opinion, stops feeling random and things starts to finally click. But most photographers, they stop here, and that's actually a huge mistake in my opinion. Because there's one Lightroom technique almost no one talks about, but professionals use it all the time. And my friend, I break it down in depth in this video right here.